with insurance. Your wisdom tonight, anointing us with the how. Your wonders tonight, unto glory. Thou hast made a way for us. You've called us to be. You've made us free. We're laying out. Oh, God. Send the rain, Lord. Send the rain. Send the rain. Send the rain. Send the rain, Jesus. Send the rain. Send the rain. Send the rain. Wonderful Savior. Wonderful day. Give the light of rain of your will to do, of your presence, giving the deliverance to all. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
You don't need another political uprising. We don't need another conqueror on the scene. What we need is a special word that will burn within our hearts and give us direction from above. We need a word from the Lord, a word from the Lord, just one word from the Lord will move all the doubts and cause the sun to shine and give peace of mind. Speak, Lord, speak. Lord, we lack thy wisdom and thy understanding. Lord, we lack the very love you show in the sun. Lord, we walked in thy ways, and we stand so much to gain. So give us your word, Lord. Speak, Lord. We need a word from the Lord. A just one word from the Lord will move all the doubts and cause the sun to shine and give a peace of mind. Speak, Lord.
Praise the Lord, Greater Glory family. We're here on another Thursday night, a chance to be challenged in the Word of God. Hopefully you found time to tune in with us. And let's have a word of prayer before we start our evening Bible study. Father, in the name of Jesus, here we are again in your divine word, seeking strength to help in the time of need. We pray that you would give those listeners ears to hear what the Spirit has to say to them. Open up the minds of our understanding. Let us be blessed because of what we heard through your divine word tonight. And we shall give your name the praise and glory because you are yet God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you, saints. We are here to be challenged again with the word of God. And I teach so often that we as believers must not find ourselves with unrealistic expectations. As I share so often that in the old church, they taught us that this was a suffering way. They taught us that everything would not go well with us, but they gave us an eternal hope as opposed to a temporary hope in this world. And so hopefully tonight I'll be able to challenge you with the word of God, and in the midst of all that's going on with you and other people in the world, that you will find hope. For the Bible says if we have hope in this life only, we are of all men most miserable. Just before we start the lesson in John 16 and 33, scripture says, "These things I've spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace, because in the world ye shall have tribulations. But be of good cheer, because I have overcome the world." And so here the Bible, if it's read distinctly, tells us that in him we have peace, but in the world we have trouble and we have tribulations. The Bible also tells us to love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. It's not the things that are in the world that brings joy and peace to the believer. Because if you can do some searching in retrospect, you'll find that those things of the world are the very things that cause us not to come to God. And those things that are in the world, those temporary pleasures, are the same things that affect our relationship with God and our peace and joy that we have in him. So then, it's only when we're walking in the flesh that we become desirous of the things of the world. And so our challenge tonight is to set our affections on things above and not on things of the earth. Our subject tonight is the joy of the Lord is your strength. The joy of the Lord is your strength. So when we read this word in Nehemiah 8, verses 8 to 12, 8 to the 12th verse, when reading the Word of God, we must read the Word of God distinctly. Make no assumptions relative to what the Word means, but read it distinctly, and then you'll find clarity in the Word of God. And so Nehemiah 8 and 8 says, "So they read in the book, in the law of God distinctly, and gave the sense, and caused them to understand the reading." Verse 9. When the word was being taught, all the people wept. They wept because they did not understand what the word of God meant. Verse 10, "Then he said unto them, Go your way, eat the fat, and drink the sweet, and send portions unto them who nothing is prepared. For this day is holy unto the Lord. Neither be ye sorry, for the joy of the Lord is your strength." Now keep in mind that they were telling them, they were reading the word, the law, and because they did not read it distinctly nor understand it, they begin to weep in a time when they should have been rejoicing. He said, this is the Lord's day. This day is holy unto the Lord. And they specifically told them not to weep, but to rejoice. And so I'm going to do the same thing tonight. Even though this is a dark time and I'm not professing that I'm feeling all happy and jubilant about what's going on, amen, but I'm trying to find my peace in the Word of God. If it wasn't for this word, amen, this word that I have here, amen, I would not be able to make it because things are not going well. Things are not going good. Physically, I'm not necessarily as well as I desire. But yet the word of God tells me to rejoice, not because of my circumstances, but rejoice in the eternal hope that I have in Christ Jesus. So keep focused that our joy and our peace is in him and not in the things of the world. So they said unto them, that this day is holy unto our Lord. Neither be ye sorry, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. Amen. So if you read it distinctly, add no assumptions to it, the joy of the Lord is your strength. So what does the scripture say your strength is? What does the scripture say your strength is? Where does our strength come from? Without any assumptions, the joy of the Lord is our strength. The joy of the Lord is our strength. Our strength comes from knowing and believing what the word says. Knowing and believing what the priest read to them is what produces joy. Has nothing to do with circumstances. Amen. When David prayed in Psalms 51 and 12, he says this. He says, restore unto me the joy of my salvation. Not the joy of the riches that I have, not the joy of all the pleasures that I have, not the joy of the position that I have, but restore the joy of my salvation. Amen. So the joy that we're talking about is knowing that Jesus Christ has pardoned our sins, has forgiven our sins. Amen. We're talking about something that is eternal and not something that is external and something that is fleeting. Amen. So the term joy is simply knowing how much Christ has done for you, knowing how much God through Christ has done for you, produces what we call the joy of the Lord. We're not talking about the joy of the world. We're not talking about the joy of having pleasures. We're not talking about the joy of everything going well with us. We're talking about the joy of the Lord, knowing what Christ has done. The fact that you repented of your sins, you accepted him as personal savior. He now calls us sons of God, amen. And he has positioned us in the heavenly places with him. And the hope we have is beyond this world, amen. We're talking about joy that produces constant gladness and inner strength, amen. An inner strength that produces spiritual strength. What we need in this day is spiritual strength. Natural strength is good, but there's times when I'm not physically strong, excuse me, but I am still spiritually strong. Amen. John 15 and 11, Jesus describes it as his joy. He says this joy belongs to him, and he's the one that deposited this joy at salvation in us. He says that my joy may be fulfilled in them. My joy, his joy. This joy is in us, regardless again of circumstances. The joy is in us. The Bible says, you know the story, that if you believe on me, as the scripture has said, if you read it distinctly without assumptions, he said, if you believe on me, as the scripture has said, out of your innermost being will flow rivers of living water, automatically flowing, springing up in us, regardless of outward and external circumstances. This joy would flow automatically out of us. The joy of the Lord should not be affected by external circumstances. Amen. We should not lose our joy. You know the song we used to sing, I've got J-O-Y joy, joy in the Holy Ghost. Don't let the devil steal your joy. Don't let the devil steal your joy. The joy in the Holy Ghost. Amen. But often it suppresses, negative circumstances suppresses the joy because somehow it pushes it into the residue of our mind and it makes us forget what God has done. We sing all kinds of songs that are given with the content and intentions for us to remember what God has done. Jesus, I'll never forget what you've done for me. Jesus, I'll never forget how you set me free. Jesus, I'll never forget how you brought me out. I'll never forget. No, never. And when I think of the goodness of Jesus and all that he has done for me, then my soul cries out, hallelujah. Thank God for saving me. And so our challenge tonight is for us to focus more on the things above than the things of the earth, because this is a dark time. And no one can say it's not. It's a time of sorrow, a time of grieving. of time of wonder, not knowing what tomorrow is going to bring. But we need to focus, balance our lives out by thinking on the things that God has done for us and our eternal salvation in Him. Amen. And so the external things should not affect our eternal joy and peace that we have. Amen. Because what we have is everlasting joy, and joy that is unspeakable, and peace that surpasses all understanding. So the challenge is that when the tests and trials come against us, we cannot control them. Amen. We cannot control the wind. We cannot control the circumstances that come to us. But what we can control is the joy that gives us spiritual strength to endure the tests and trials that come. So we must focus on one thing that we can control, which is our relationship with Christ. I mentioned that so often to people that are going through dark moments, individuals that are struggling and have so much opposition coming against them, things that are beyond their control. And I always leave them with this one phrase: the only thing you can control is your relationship with God. Amen. Many times when I'm overwhelmed and the enemy brings it to my mind and things come to my mind, praise the Lord, and doubt comes to my mind, I respond, I talk to myself, and I say to myself, in spite of all that's happening, I am saved. Amen. I have salvation. Amen. I'm saved now, regardless of what would happen. Amen. My hope is not just in this life, but I have hope for eternal life, which is in Christ. Amen. So when we properly understand, amen, the joy is automatic. It's what we believe that causes the joy to spring up. Amen. If we believe as it is written in Scripture, then out of our innermost being flows this river of living water. Amen. This peace that surpasses all understanding. Amen. And so we must keep in mind, praise the Lord, we must keep in mind that God is still blessing us. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. And so Hebrews 12 and 2 tells us that we're looking unto Jesus. We're fixing our eyes on Jesus. We're not fixing our eyes or our minds on things that are beneath, but things that are above. Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him, amen, not the agony of Calvary, but the joy that was set before him, he was able to endure the cross and despising the shame. And now he sits down on the right hand of God, amen, receiving his eternal purpose and destiny, amen. But God is still faithful to us and faithful to his word, amen. The joy of the Lord is our strength, amen. Remember, it's believing what the word says that produces this supernatural strength. It's believing what God has spoken us that encourages us when tough times have come. It's believing that God is faithful to his word, and his word does not return void, but it accomplishes the purpose whereunto he has sent it. And so even with all of our technical difficulties, amen, you should still have joy. Amen. Praise the Lord. And even if I disappeared for a moment, amen, hopefully you still were able to hear the word of God going forth. Amen. So even as we try to perfect our social media, there are always going to be some interruptions. Life has interruptions. Amen. But what does it do? Does it discourage you from listening? Amen. Sometimes I'll get a few texts and people will tell me, well, you blanked out or you froze or whatever. That's life. That's the real world. Amen. But what's important is, did you hear the word of God? On Sunday we had, I thought was a good word. As far as the content, we had a good word. But there were some social media glitches, some things that happened. But when I listened to it, even though it froze on certain occasions, I could still hear the spoken word. Brothers and sisters, what is important to us is the spoken word. Let's say, for instance, the social media crashes and you cannot even receive the word. Amen. Then what are you going to do? I thought about that today. I have enough hidden word that if I could no longer get the written word or the spoken word, I have enough hidden word in my heart that will take me through until Jesus changed the circumstances. My hope is built on what he says in his word, not my circumstances, not how I feel, not what people say, amen, but what the word of God says. And the word of God says to us that we need to change our perspectives, change our directions, and when things are tough and things are going rough, which are supposed to be expected as a believer, trials are going to come, fiery trials, temptations are going to come, sickness comes, pandemics come, amen, times of need come, times of worry, mental anguish comes, but yet we can focus on him. I read the scripture, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. What does the scripture say? Read it distinctly. For the joy that was set before him, he endured. Not for the agony of the cross that he was facing, but for the joy, knowing that if he endured, amen, the joy that gave him the ability or the supernatural strength to endure, amen, that's what gave him the strength. For the joy that was set before him, he endured. For the joy that you have, you and I have, we endure. We press, amen, towards the mark of the prize of the high calling, which is in Christ Jesus. Amen. So you think about the joy, not that's set before you, but the joy that's been deposited in you. The joy of the Lord is your strength. Amen. Amen. 1 Peter 4:12. He says, beloved. Now, if you read again, I love to read the word distinctly. Beloved. That's an endearing term. Beloved. Amen. Think it not strange. Think it not strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you as though some strange thing has happened to you. I'm going to read that again because the challenge tonight is to read the word of God distinctly. Amen. Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you as though some strange thing has happened to you. But do what? Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. And so then if you read the word, if you read the word distinctly, amen, he labels it as fiery trials. Amen. So fiery trials for the believer, they're normal. Fiery trials are normal for the believer. Amen. These things happen to good people, bad people, but according to the word of God, it's promised that we will have fiery trials. Beloved saints of God, look at Psalms 34:19. It says to us, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivereth him out of them all. So then we have promised fiery trials, tests that's going to come against us, situations that we cannot control, but yet God gives us the victory through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So the focus should not be on the fiery trial, but rather on the faith in God giving us victory. So then you can rejoice even though fiery trials are coming. Because if you read the word distinctly, amen, God says he delivers us out of them all. Amen. And so I think maybe the problem is, and I have this issue too, is that we're focusing on, amen, afflictions. Amen. Focusing on afflictions. Amen. But what we want to do tonight is try focusing on, amen, and fixing our eyes and setting our minds, amen, on things above. But the Lord delivereth them out of them all. So if you get some bad news, but the Lord delivereth them out of them all. You have a health problem, an issue, amen, mental anguish, emotional issue, but the Lord delivereth them out of them all, as opposed to focusing on that present situation. Amen. So that should produce joy. You should be feeling better now. I'm feeling better. I'm feeling better than I was before I sat down here. Amen. Because of the word. I'm believing the word that I'm teaching you. Amen. God's people were weeping as the priests were teaching them in Nehemiah 8. They were weeping, amen, because they did not understand the word. And then the scripture says, and then the priest gave them understanding. When the priest gave them understanding, the same words that made them sorrowful and weep, they begin to rejoice. And so hopefully you are in a position now where you feel better. You may not be happy, glad, but you should feel better now as we go through this word. He says his words are spirit and they are life producing. If you believe it, simply receiving this word by faith should make you feel better. Amen. It's to change your attitude. It's to change your disposition simply by believing the word. Amen. So some of us, amen, may be fearing the virus. Amen. Most people are. I don't care how saved you are. If you have any kind of sense, you're fearing the virus. Amen. Because no one has become totally immune from it. Amen. And it's being exposed to everyone. If we don't take certain precautions, amen, it can happen to me. And I was sitting there, and to be honest with you, I have my concerns. Amen. You can call them fears, whatever. I have my concerns. And then I happened to be watching something on the YouTube or the Facebook, and I saw a young preacher. And this is the portion I caught. Amen. He was talking about the virus. Amen. He was talking about the pandemic. And he was in feeling good because of his confidence in God's word. He said these words, if God protects me and covers me, he says, I'm blessed. He says, if I catch the virus, I'm still blessed. He said, if I recover from the virus, I'm still blessed. Then he said, if I don't, I'm still blessed, even if I succumb to it. So what he was saying, that because God declared in his word by reading it distinctly, that circumstances does not negate what God has said he was or who he was. He says, I am blessed. So he said the circumstances, if I catch it, I'm blessed. If I recover, I'm blessed. If I don't recover, I'm blessed. So regardless of our circumstances, if you believe that in those circumstances you're yet blessed, again, it produces spiritual strength. And that's what we need in this hour. We need spiritual strength. Amen. Because some of us are tired. I'm tired. Maybe because I can't sleep as well as I desire or as I need. Amen. But I do have spiritual strength. Amen. And so we're praying that God will increase your spiritual strength. So then hopefully from that example, regardless of your present circumstances, if you believe this testimony, you should have said, even though my circumstances haven't changed, I'm blessed. Amen. Amen. You should declare that with me right now. Come on. Are you ready? Declare with me right now. I'm blessed. Amen. Amen. Have you ever been greeting the saints of old. Amen. They had no sad stories. Amen. You would ask them how they were doing. They would say, I'm blessed. Amen. They might not have had food on the table, but they say, I'm blessed. Or if they told you what the circumstances were, they say, yeah, but I'm blessed. Amen. You are blessed, saints of God. You are blessed because you're in Christ. Again, we're trying to change what we're focusing on, what we're fixing our minds on. Amen. Because there's enough negative stuff. I know my wife used to tell me all the time before this pandemic, she says, the reason that you're down emotionally all the time, because you watch too much news. There's nothing but negative stuff on the news when I watch it. Amen. So I try to watch some other shows now. Amen. It's working a little bit, but my joy is because of who I am in God, and I'm blessed. Amen. So you were saved in the midst of the trial, saved in the midst of this pandemic. None of that changes our position in God. Amen. Amen. Our peace is in him. Amen. Our joy comes from him. This fleshly stuff that we don't have. Amen. I don't know about you, but I've lost my desire for fleshly stuff because I'm seeking him now. And this time of being shut in and homebound has drawn me closer to God. I believe I'm stronger now than I was before these restrictions came because nothing matters to me now. The only thing matters to me now is my relationship with God. And if that's intact, I can handle, I can cope. I have supernatural strength to deal with these things that I have no control over. So then, what is joy? Joy is the emotion that's evoked by the well-being, the success, the good fortune, the receiving of what is desired. Now, that's a natural definition of joy. That's not the joy of the Lord. Let me read it again. Joy, the emotion that's evoked by well-being, success, good fortune, receiving what is desired. Amen. And it's amazing how when we receive natural stuff, how excited we get. A new car, we get excited. A promotion, we get excited. Amen. A simple gift, a simple birthday gift, we get excited. Amen. But here we are, amen, as the people of God, with joy that's unspeakable, residing in us, deposited in us by Jesus Christ. And yet for one reason, we forget. And then again, we don't have the faith to believe that these circumstances do not have the power to suppress our joy. You have to believe that. If you believe as the scripture says, you have to believe it like the scripture says. The scripture says you can rejoice and be exceeding glad. Amen. The scripture says it. And if you believe it, you will. Amen. Many times, praise the Lord, when I'm praying about a negative situation, and I'm sure you've experienced it too, you start making your petition before God, and then the next thing you know, you find yourself praising Him and thanking Him, even though physically and emotionally you feel the pain, you feel down, but then you start praising Him and magnifying Him because now that spiritual joy is giving you supernatural strength to cope with your problem. Let's look at 1 Peter 1 and 8. In Him, again, we're reading the Word of God distinctly. That's why I'm teaching at a slower pace. In Him, through Him, amen, in Him and through Him. So now we see Him, amen. Now we don't see Him, yet we believe in Him. We don't see Him now, but we believe in Him. So what happened when we had the glitch, amen, in the cameras, and maybe you didn't see me. I don't know exactly what happened, but you didn't see me. But it took faith, amen, for you to sit there in hopes that it would come back on, in hopes, amen, that the program would continue. You had to believe that because I'm sure, because I do it sometimes, if I'm viewing something on social media, I was watching CNN, and CNN had similar problems. And when CNN had the problem, I turned immediately to Fox. So I wouldn't be surprised that if we have some glitches in our social media that you may turn it off and go watch somebody else. But guess what? You won't get the word, the rhema word that's spoken here. So don't focus on what you see. Don't focus on seeing me. Have an ear to hear what's being said to you, because what is being said to you is more important than what you see. Amen. What is being said to you is more important. So 1 Peter says, in Him, though now ye see Him not, yet believing, ye rejoice with joy that's unspeakable and full of glory. Let's read it distinctly again. 1 Peter 1 and 8. In Him, though now ye see Him not, yet believing, there's the word, yet believing, ye rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. Joy unspeakable and full of glory. For what? The hope that you have, the promises that God has made, the multiple promises in God's word is again what produces joy. That's what makes us rejoice. That's what makes us praise Him. Amen. Because we believe that word. The problem is not in our not receiving, but the problem is with us not believing. So the problem is not in our not receiving, but it's not believing. The scripture said we don't see Him, amen, but yet we believe. Praise the Lord. And so faith, you know the scripture, faith is the substance of things hoped for. It's the evidence of things not seen. Amen. And so then we trust God, even though we don't see Him. We trust God, even though we haven't received Him. We trust God, because when we read His word distinctly, His word says it. Amen. The word says we can rejoice with joy unspeakable, unexplainable, full of glory. Amen. So this day, as they said in verse 10, in Nehemiah 8 and 10, for this day is holy unto the Lord, neither be sorry. Now, I know somebody is saying, well, Pastor, you don't know what I'm going through. No, I don't. And you don't know what I'm going through. And I'm not putting into the equation what you're going through and what I'm going through. What I'm giving you tonight is what the Word says we can do when what we're going through is against us. So the challenge for us today is to, this day is holy unto the Lord, neither be sorry. Not about the circumstance. We're not talking about that. For the joy of the Lord is your strength. Knowing God in the pardon of your sins, in the midst of what you're going through, produces joy, produces strength. The joy of knowing what Christ has done for us. He saved me. He has forgiven me. Amen. He lives and takes up his abode on the inside of me. And that's what automatically produces strength. Amen. We think of joy, we think it's when people are running and jumping and yelling and screaming and praising God and falling out. Amen. That's just a natural response, an emotional response to something that you believe that has happened supernaturally. Amen. Amen. Someone said, I can't explain it. Amen. Sometimes it is unspeakable. It's unexplainable. You just feel it. Sometimes I'm rejoicing. And if you ask me, was there any particular thing that happened or something different? My circumstances are the same, but yet I have joy that's been produced by knowing, amen, what God has done for me and what he's promised. Jesus confirms this in Luke 10, verses 17 through 20. The Bible says, and when the 70 returned, they returned with joy. The 70 returned with this emotion, amen, that was invoked by their success, their good fortune, satisfying stuff. Some good things happened to them while they were out preaching the gospel. And so let's examine, amen, what caused them to rejoice. Why were they rejoicing? This is what the Bible said. They said, devils were subject unto us. Amen. Devils were subject to them. So I assume they cast out devils and they wrought miracles. Amen. But listen to what Jesus says in verse 20. Jesus says, notwithstanding in this rejoice. So it's okay to do that. Amen. Amen. Not rejoice in that only, that the spirits are subject to you, but rather rejoice that your names are written down in the Lamb book of life. Now, what an interruption. What an interruption. They're coming back after preaching. Jesus will send them out two by two and says, the devils are subject to us. We've cast demons out. We've wrought miracles. Amen. And we rejoice and we have this emotion because positive things happen to us. Jesus said, this is not the only thing you should be shouting about, but rejoice in this, that your names are written down in the Lamb's book of life. Amen. Think about that, saints. The most important thing at the end of the day is that your name is written down in the Lamb's book of life. Amen. Amen. So let's begin to rejoice even now. Let's begin to rejoice even now. Well, you say, well, Pastor, you're not preaching and you're not jubilant. Amen. You don't have the Hammond B3s backing you up. There's no tambourines being played. Maybe that's part of our problem. Maybe the only reason that we're rejoicing is because we're responding to fleshly emotions. Amen. But this word, this spoken word is what makes you rejoice. This spoken word is what produces real joy and real peace. Amen. This is what should produce your strength. Amen. Not because there's a certain sound, praise the Lord, but the written word itself. These words are spirit and they are life producing. So the joy is, if you read the word distinctly, that your name is written down in the Lamb book of life, if that doesn't make you rejoice, no matter how it's presented to you, whether it's read to you, whether I'm preaching with a certain vibration of preaching and yelling and screaming and the music is backing me, tambourines are playing, but if you don't believe your name is written down in the Lamb's book of life, then why are you rejoicing? Amen. I just wish there was somebody listening from the old church, because I keep making reference to them. In the old church, the saints would be shouting before the musicians play. The musicians would have to catch up with them. Saints would be shouting in the midst of trying to give a testimony of what God has done for them. Amen. They didn't have to have a certain sound or certain atmosphere for them to rejoice. It was when they thought about the goodness of Jesus and all he had done for them, they would find, you would find them rejoicing. Amen. And so we need to, brothers and sisters, to focus more on what God says in his word than what's happening around us. I'm not saying not to pay attention to it, but we have to be careful that when it starts taking our joy and causing us emotional distress, that's the time to look into the word of God, read it distinctly, and believe what it says. It'll give you spiritual strength to endure, amen, what you're going through. Look at Colossians 3 and 2. Colossians 3 and 2. Now he says, set your affections. That's something you have to do. Set your affections on things above and not on things of the earth, where the moth and dust doth corrupt and thieves break through and steal. Don't set your affections on this perishing stuff. Amen. This natural stuff, this fleeting stuff, this temporary stuff. Look at the number of people that have lost their jobs. Amen. Look at the number of people that have lost their health. Look at the number of people that have almost lost their minds. Amen. Fleshly stuff, carnal stuff. Amen. But we're talking about eternal stuff. The song says, build your hopes on things eternal, then hold to God's unchanging hand. Verse 3 says to us, ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. I'm really feeling better now because my life is hid with Christ in God. Verse 4, when Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. Now, what I'm doing now, again, at a slow pace, I'm reading the word distinctly. Amen. Reading the word distinctly. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him. How can we read this word distinctly and then not rejoice? How can we believe this and not shout for joy? There's nothing greater than this to be found. Number one, your name written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. Amen. To be saved. Praise the Lord. Amen. To have been forgiven for your sins and have eternal life abiding in you right now. Amen. That should produce joy if you believe it as it is written. Amen. So there are times when we must change our mindset, and this is the time. As I share with you often, I try to be transparent. I'm teaching you what I need to do myself. That's why I have this lesson. This lesson was given to me. I need to set my affections on things above. I need to change my mindset and quit focusing, amen, most of my time and energy on the negative. And I need to, man, look, David said, I'll lift my eyes unto the hills from whence cometh my help. All of my help comes from the Lord. Not that stuff is not happening here, but I can't focus on that all the time and expect to be emotionally, amen, and spiritually strong. Amen. Praise the Lord. So I found that praying is the most effective way to set your mind on things above. Because if you're really praying, the Bible says we don't know what to pray for, how we ought. We don't even know how to pray as we ought. But the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings that cannot be uttered. Amen. Sometimes when I'm praying and I'm petitioning God, the next thing I know before I finish that petition, I'm praising God. Amen. I'm praising God. And so the challenge is, what do you do between your petitioning God, amen, and you're waiting for God to respond? You've got to have something that gives you hope. The Bible said the hope that we have is the anchor of your soul. Amen. You have to have something that will anchor you down while you're waiting for God to change this negative situation. So Colossians 3 said, all right, that we must set our affections on things above. Set our affections on things above. Praise the Lord. You got to read the word distinctly was one of our challenges. Then the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, helps us to mortify the flesh. Amen. The Spirit of God helps us. If we, through the Spirit, mortify the deeds of the flesh, then we have life. Amen. You'll start losing desire for fleshly stuff, and you'll hunger and thirst for the things of God. Nothing wrong with fleshly stuff. It just means that we're not supposed to put it before God. Amen. If we would seek after the spiritual stuff as much as we seek after the fleshly stuff, we'll be stronger believers. Amen. But what I'm experiencing in this time is that I'm losing desire for that kind of stuff. Not sinful stuff, but stuff, this a better term would be distracting stuff. I've lost a desire for it. I can have it, not have it. I don't have to have anything but peace with God. And that's where I am right now. So set your affections on things above. And so if we focus on things above as much as we focus on things that are down below, amen, we would be stronger in God. Amen. The Bible says it like this: for where your treasure is, there is your heart also. Where your treasure is, the things that you're most focused on. Amen. Our treasures, according to the word of God, is in heaven. Our minds should be set on heavenly things and not on the carnal things. And so if you read this word distinctly, amen, this day is holy unto the Lord. Weep not, neither mourn. And you say, well, Pastor, how can I do it? Simply believing that the joy of the Lord is your strength. Amen. Even when we come to church, whenever we get a chance to come back together, when we come to church, we can sing that song, I get joy when I think about what he's done for me. And most times when we're singing because things are going well with us. But what do you do now when it's a time naturally to be weeping and time to be discouraged? Well, I suggest that we focus on what God says in his word in spite of the negative circumstances, in spite of what's going on, in spite of how the wind is blowing, how contrary it might be. Amen. Neither weep. We're talking about being depressed. Neither weep, but rejoice for the joy of the Lord, not of the world, not for the flesh, but the joy of the Lord. The joy of knowing God should be enough to make you shout in the midst of this. Should be enough to take the edge off that otherwise dark and bland situation. Brothers and sisters, I know this is a challenge. I know this is a dark moment, but this is a day. This is a day that God wants you to rejoice. And so what I suggest you do, very simple, I wrote this: stay home, stay healthy, stay happy, and most importantly, stay holy. Let me try it again. Stay home, stay healthy, stay happy, and most importantly, stay holy. Amen. For the joy of the Lord is your strength. You've got to verbalize it now. You read it in his word, now you can speak it. And when the depression comes, you say, yeah, but the joy of the Lord is my strength. He gives me peace that surpasses all understanding. And my brothers and sisters, if you believe this tonight, if you believe it tonight, amen, you can receive joy that's unspeakable, full of glory in the midst of this otherwise dark situation. Pray with me. Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for your word that is written. Thank you for the word that is so simple that we can have clear understanding. I pray in the name of Jesus that the words spoken and the words that were written will be believed on by your people, that our faith will be encouraged, that we will set our affections on things above and not on things of the earth. And somehow, God, you will restore us to a place where we have peace and joy that's unspeakable and peace that surpasses all understanding in the midst of this otherwise dark moment. We pray for the peace of God that will be resting upon your people who now have heard your word and mixed it with faith. Because when the word is mixed with faith, it produces joy that's unspeakable. Bless your people and keep them in the center of your will. We should forever give you praise and glory because you're God. In Jesus' name. And all the people of God said amen. Brothers and sisters, thank you so much, amen, for viewing tonight. I hope and pray that we said something to challenge you and encourage you into God's word. And thank you so much for your support that has been coming in. And we just thank you so much for that. It's obvious you believe his word because you are being blessed, amen, by him, even in this dark situation. Amen. Stay safe, be blessed, and rejoice. God bless you, saints.